Welcome back, everybody. I hope you had a good conversation over the lunch and that you're now refreshed enough to be listening to some more conversations and discussions here and presentations. And the next part of our program is presentations on innovation to boost eco-design. So we've heard before lunch, eco-design to boost innovation, but in what essence are innovation boosting eco-design? That's what we are going to discuss now in the next four presentations. And the first of them will be given by Mr. Chalendra Madgal from BIO, Intelligence Service in France. And he will be talking on integrating innovation impacts into policy assessment, a case of energy using products. Welcome, the floor is yours.
Well, good afternoon. I would like to thank, first of all, eceee for inviting me. And I'm glad I could make it, because despite all the snow and trains being cancelled, I was not sure if I could reach and if I would be awake, because I just came back from Canada yesterday, so I'm a bit jet lagged. So wake me up if I fall asleep while speaking. So this work which I'm presenting today is, it's not moving anyway, it's okay. It's a brief piece of research we did for DEFRA in 2010. So I would say it's slightly old, but I think it's as relevant as it was at that time. But then the disclaimer applies that whatever I say, it's my views, and you know DEFRA has nothing to agree or disagree whatever I'm talking. Even though the work was fully funded by DEFRA. And this work we did with the Policy Studies Institute in the UK and Bio together. This, I think everybody knows, I don't have to tell that how the product policy have been evolving. Our focus was very UK, so we were not looking at it from the European perspective. But the main idea behind was that most of the impact assessments, the market transformation program in the UK was doing, the innovation angle was almost absent. And this point was raised at different occasions, especially by the analysts of MTP. And then the DEFRA thought it would be a good idea to explore this area, how innovation could be taken into account in any policy assessments in the future. So what we did was, I would say, very first step in this direction. And I think it gave interesting results, but it's a bit tricky, as I will show you. Especially with the increasing complexity of products, it becomes more and more difficult to judge where to put the cost of innovation. But in terms of policy, we know that we are moving towards, we have both approaches from demand and supply side, as presented this morning. What we try to see is that what is the role of innovation in influencing the cost faced by the manufacturers in response to any policy intervention, whether it's from demand or supply side. Kind of focus was on energy labeling, because I think this work was a lot of econometric analysis, so we needed a lot of data. And the only area where the data was available was the energy labeling directive, because we had market data, we had cost data. So look, seeing things from two different perspectives, the on one hand you have the regulatory cost, and then you have the case of implementing measures like in the EUP. So there are many questions. Many people say that, okay, if you have a more efficient appliance, it's the manufacturer who keeps a large premium in his pocket. On the other hand, some policy analysts, they say, well, the manufacturer, he pass on all the cost to the consumer, so for the manufacturer, it doesn't matter, you know, whatever cost, additional cost he may require for R&D, et cetera. So there is some truth, some lies, you know, it's a mix of things. So we can't say that it's that transparent or that easy to pass on all the cost to consumers. It depends on the products, it depends on the maturity level, it depends on the status of the technology. So there were many questions which were different parts of this puzzle. We try to tackle some, not all. So what kind of regulatory costs we were looking at? So first, of course, is the increased administration cost. For example, monitoring and reporting requirements, certification cost. Then the decreased unit profitability of existing products, because some of this cost cannot be passed on to the consumers. Then additional investment in R&D and in the production phase, especially in the prototype and the very first production batches. And then change in the sales also, if the consumers are willing to buy the more efficient and energy efficient products or not. So in terms of innovation induced by these products, so we saw that with any policy intervention, we saw that there's an introduction of new and more efficient products. That's one way to look at it, but then also how fast they can penetrate the market. So again, the market penetration issue was a critical one. And innovation has an impact on regulatory cost because it affects, of course, the production cost, also the unit prices and the sales. But for each of these things, there are different elements to keep into account. When I say current impact assessment, this is the impact assessments MTP used to do at that time, 2009, 2010. So they were just an example. It was, I took an example of costs and benefits, and in the cost it says, cost to manufacturers, negligible. So it was always, there was no cost for, taken into account, which comes from designing innovative products. And most of the costs you see are there on consumers, or whether it's for switching lamps or luminaries or other costs. So typically these assessments, they assume that there's a full pass through to consumers. And most of these estimates were based on expert opinions because we were looking at the cost data, and cost data is a very confidential data, not many manufacturers wanted to give. So it was always based on a subjective judgment, which also influenced the overall assessment. So if you want to see the evidence of innovation, most of you must have seen this chart from Bertoldi's report that the energy efficiency of products on the market has been increasing. There's no doubt. At the same time, we also know that the prices have fallen in real terms. So here is, you see the inflation, the blue line, and then the red is the washing machines and the green in the refrigeration. So we see that the price trends from in the late 70s to 2004 washing machine and fridges, and we see that the prices are falling with time. Then there's the concept of experience curves and learning rates. I won't go into this because I know that next two presenters are going to really focus on these two angles, but at least what we can see is that there's a range within which we see the learning rates for prices and cost of, I would say, more household energy using products. And the evidence of experience curve effect in relation to energy efficiency, we see that it's in the range of 30 to 35%. And there's an acceleration over time, maybe because of policy intervention to a certain extent. Then another evidence of innovation, we have seen that when using energy efficiency classes, we can see that the progress of energy efficient products compared to the energy consuming ones, it's again a trend which all of us are quite familiar. So what we did in this project was we developed a forecasting model, because we saw that most of the assessments were based from a cost angle, but not seeing it from a market share point of view. And we thought that each approach has its advantages and drawbacks, but if we use these two approaches together, we can maybe get a fair idea of how much innovation is really contributing to the increased penetration of these products. So in the price, we looked at the simple regression analysis based on the data which we had. So what we wanted to estimate was the price premium which we can attribute to the energy efficiency, because this is never very clear what comes from energy efficiency and what comes just because there is no competing product in front of us. And then on sales, we tried to correlate between relative energy efficiency and sales at energy class level. So here we tried to look at what was the pattern of technology diffusion. I'll come back to these issues in detail when I show which main indicators we used for the analysis. So data we used was the sales data at product level, which comes from JFK, most of it. That's again a bit tricky situation, is that I can't present the whole report because it's not published by DEFRA publicly. So they have only published a summary report which is available, but I think if you ask DEFRA, they might provide you, because we also developed a kind of Excel-based simulator tool which enabled these calculations in a rather, I would say, easy manner. So very few assumptions you have to give, and then it had all the historic data in the database, and it could do the regression analysis on its own. So we looked at the appliances where we had some data, like fridges, dishwashers, washing machines. And then the intuition behind the forecasting model was that the rate of replacement and appearance of new model is somehow related with innovation. Because as we see the market share of energy labeled fridges and their average prices, we can see the trend when they enter the market at a very high end and then they leave the market at the bottom. So you follow this continuing trend, which is, it can be correlated, and I'll show you how we correlate it. So we developed this indicator of relative energy efficiency because we realized that the absolute energy efficiency doesn't tell us anything linked to innovation. So what we did was that this ERI, we calculated as the median ranking of each energy efficiency label. So like one for the most efficient product and zero for the least efficient product. And therefore it tracks the decline of the product as the more efficient products come on the market and the others, they disappear. And the product sale price is determined by its competitive position on the market. So there are certain very strong assumptions which also affect the analysis in this case. And then the second concept was the energy efficiency class life. So this we define the time it takes from a top energy class to become the bottom one. So how many years it takes for example, if you see here the green on the left, which reaches to yellow on the right. So this average efficiency class life can be considered also an indicator of rate of innovation, how fast the innovation is happening. It doesn't matter if it's happening because of a push from a policy or because of the technology evolution on its own. And then the third thing was the energy efficiency class life. So how much time it takes the top energy class to become the least efficient class and it's allowed to leave the market. So there again, we do it between 1 and 0 to see when the energy efficiency classes drop from the most efficient to the least efficient. And then there's a question of innovation premium and innovation pattern. So the premium is, we defined it as the sale price difference between the most efficient and the least efficient product on the market at any given moment. And the innovation pattern was the diffusion and the disappearance of the models, which is correlated again with the energy ranking indicator I defined a little ago. So with these 4-5 parameters, we were able to model, and we were quite surprised that for looking at different product groups, it gave us very consistent results. And we saw that there was a good change in the market share. We could predict that change in market share, but there was again an assumption that the overall proportion will not change. So between the least efficient and the most efficient, it will always come to 100%. So that's again a very strong assumption, I agree. But then that was the only way we could put it in the empirical model we had designed. So we did case studies for fridges, domestic lighting, televisions, and motor. And we saw that for fridges, television, motors, it gave us very consistent results. But in lighting, it didn't work very well. I think there were two cases where this concept doesn't work very well. One is when you have the different technologies competing in the same product group. Like for fridges, for washing machines, it was simple because it was the same technology. But if you take the case of lamps where you have competing technologies, it's difficult to attribute a innovation factor to one technology or the other. So there our model doesn't perform very well. And the second case where it didn't work was when there's a strong policy intervention, like a ban on incandescent light bulb. So that suddenly disappears from the market. And we can't really see, because our assumption is that it should enter at certain level and leave at certain level. But if it leaves in between, the regression doesn't give very consistent results. So findings from these case studies, we saw that the simulator is applicable to most product categories through the optional tools we had, whether it's a nonlinear trend in sales and prices, and even very complex scenario for minimum standards. It can take into account diverse policy scenarios, both from supply and demand side. And we could also do a combination of policies like energy label with the minimum efficiency standard. So you don't have to do it one by one. It could tackle multiple policies applied at the same time on the same product. But as I said, the methodology can be applied under specific condition, as I gave the example of light bulbs where the model didn't work. And then we need a sensitivity analysis to take into account to explain why the results were varying. Just the model doesn't give you an absolute, I would say, answer to the question. But then we did different simulations by varying the 4 parameters which I mentioned to show that how they were affecting the overall results. But this was also dependent on the quality of data we had behind, because for fridges, we had very good data, so we could do a very nice analysis. But for other product groups, it was like for motors, it was not that robust. So the main finding from our study was that innovation is a natural phenomena, but it can result in improving the product quality features. It improves energy efficiency and falling prices and cost. And what policy intervention can do is it can accelerate the rate of innovation to promote the faster improvements in energy efficiency. But without, we saw that that impact was really at a very short time interval. So after a while, the curve again takes this form as if there was no policy intervention. So the impact is really during a very short period when the policy intervention occurs. And any price and cost impacts are also very short-run deviations from the long-run trend of the efficiency improvements. And the penetration of the new or more efficient technology is a market-driven process. You can't always push it through a policy, and policy impact should take into account those market forces. Otherwise, you might miss out the natural evolution of those technologies in the market. So the main conclusions were that the impact assessments, which the MTP analysts were doing, they need to take into account these innovation. They do take into account these innovation effects, but not in a consistent way, depending on the product type. Sometimes we could observe that those innovation effects were visible, and most of the time it didn't take into account the heterogeneity in a given product group. So the model which we proposed with this study was it gave a kind of systematic approach to take into account the innovation impact in the policy assessments. It takes the cost of increasing energy efficiency into account. Then product prices are affected by the market position. And the sales predictions were automatically because there was the database of the market on a given product type. It was able to, as I said, assess different policy options and give a very kind of quick check if we need to analyze the effect much in detail. And I think that's the main thing, because we can't generalize this issue to all product types, and because depending on the complexity of product, the innovation angle it's very, very different. So you really need to see in a particular context how much the innovation impact can be attributed to a given product at a given, I would say, in the phase of its product development. Then there, as I said, there are some limitations also to this approach, that it cannot really model if there's any radical technology changes, because we know that especially in ICT sector, there are so fast changes in technologies which are difficult to predict. And similarly, when you have alternative technologies, as in the case of lighting, it's very difficult to model through these kind of econometric analysis. And the market structure is, as we saw in most of the case studies, it's not driven entirely by energy efficiency. It has an impact to a certain extent, but then the other factors which come in, which is more the relative importance of different indicators I presented earlier. So our recommendation was that this should be taken into account more explicitly, and I think they are doing it, because this tool was circulated to all the MTP analysts within DEFRA, and they gave very positive feedback that it was very useful for their day-to-day assessments. And this was kind of complementary to the approach they were used to, like the cost-based approach, because for this approach, market-based approach, they didn't really need any confidential data or there was no contradiction between the experts. So it was much easier to model in a way compared to the cost-based approach. So thank you. The report is there on this website of DEFRA if you want to download. But as I said, it's only the summary document which they have published. So the full technical report I have with me if somebody wants to consult. But otherwise, you may have to ask DEFRA, because they didn't decide to publish it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kalinda. And I leave the floor to Mr. Robert van Buskirk from Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, and he's going to talk about applications of experience curves in U.S. energy efficiency standards analysis. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to commend the previous speaker. We've done some looks at similar data and came with very similar results in terms of market position driving price and adoption. So So that's very good work. What I'd like to do is explain the current methods for incorporating experience curves in the US regulatory analysis. I'm going to provide a little anecdotal background. The Secretary of Energy in the US is a Dr. Stephen Chu, who's a Nobel laureate physicist. One of the things that happened is in 2010 or so, he heard that, his strategy for getting the U.S. to create solutions to climate change is to push innovation in the clean energy sector. So he discovered in 2010 that we had assumed there was no innovation in the first cost of appliances when we did our regulatory analysis. And he basically gave an order saying, you need to correct that mistake. So I'm going to describe the first order correction that has been incorporated in the US regulatory analysis for the past couple years, and which has been published in a recent energy policy paper. Also I should note that the opinions are mine and do not express the position of either my laboratory or my Department of Energy. So for more detailed technical information, there is an energy policy paper which goes into detail on the utilization of experience curves in our analysis. In the US appliance standards analysis, this is sort of a very brief summary of the process. We start with a market and technology assessment. After the market and technology assessment, there's a screening and engineering analysis that looks at the various engineering design options for improving the efficiency of the products. There's an engineering-based cost analysis to generate the price efficiency curves. Then we do an analysis that looks at the energy use differences implied by the different designs. We do a life cycle cost analysis, which is the life cycle cost impacts at the consumer level. And then we aggregate those up to a national impact analysis, sort of adds it up over an analysis period and incorporates the social cost of carbon. And then we have various other analyses that look at manufacturer impacts, utility impacts, et cetera. So this is the curve that made it obvious that the assumption of constant real appliance prices over time was unlikely to be correct. So in the constant real price assumption, assuming no innovation, that declining line of prices, which goes back 50 years, would all of a sudden stop declining and go on a flat line. And that was the thing that we've basically corrected in the past couple of years. So the motivation, we actually have an executive order that says we are supposed to use the best available techniques to quantify anticipated present future benefits and costs as accurately as possible. So all this is to increase the accuracy. And we've talked in this session about learning and innovation. There's actually a couple competing economic theories on the long-term price trends that are observed for things like appliances and durables. So I think people know about the learning curve analysis, but there's an alternative analysis which was articulated by the economist Baumol in 1965. And that alternative analysis says that when you look at different sectors of the economy, there's different economic activities which have intrinsically different labor intensities. So when you go to a symphony concert, the symphony concert will take a few hours of time for the 20 or 30 people in the symphony concert, and the productivity of that, the labor productivity of that process probably is not going to increase very much over time. Whereas if you're manufacturing a durable product, you can basically invest more and more in robots and improved designs and decrease the labor intensity of that durable product manufacturing quickly. So what that does is it makes it so that labor-intensive service sector components of the economy, if you look at their long-term price trends, those have high inflation rates. And you know, examples are medical services sector. It's always inflating more and more because medical services are intrinsically labor-intensive. Whereas the areas where the productivity of production is increasing faster declines. So this particular plot shows the red line, which is increasing. It's an inflation-adjusted price index for different sectors of the economy. The red line is the services sector, which is increasing. If you look at energy products, commodities tend to increase at the same rate as inflation. And then goods in general is decreasing. Durable goods has been decreasing, you know, basically by a factor of nearly four over the last 60 years. And household appliances has been decreasing at even a faster long-term rate. And if you look at electronics and computing, those decrease at even a faster rate. So the U.S. has the benefit of having a long-term statistical data collection, and so we can look at those very long-term trends in our prices and price indices. So the two different ways of modeling the price trends, the learning curve says that price is going to depend upon cumulative experience. I'm labeling the cumulative experience variable X, and that the cumulative experience, the price varies as a power law of the cumulative experience. Another alternative where you have different rates of productivity in different pieces of the economy, perhaps rather than the price being indexed off of cumulative experience, it's indexed off of time. You just have a certain 1 or 2% per year improvement in the productivity. In that case, it's an exponential line. In the U.S. regulatory analysis adjustments, we did our projections with both the learning curve and the exponential extrapolation methods. And since both of those extrapolations were pretty robust equations based off the same data, they tend to produce very similar results. So here's an example, which is the range of price trends for one appliance. In this case, it's probably refrigerators. And we did a range of values using the error bars of the functional fits to the historical data. So we did exponential fits, we did experience curve fits. We also had the benefit of in our forecasting, in the U.S. energy sector forecast, we incorporate some private sector macroeconomic models. And so if you talk to your macroeconomists, they may also be able to go and look at some macroeconomic models. Those macroeconomic models will be based on some economic statistics from your central economics authorities. Those models, when they do their balancing of the economic accounts, will also factor in changes in productivity, and those macroeconomic models will produce a series of price index forecasts. And so in our case, we had a price index forecast, which was for furniture. That was sort of the closest one in our macroeconomic model. And that one fell along a very similar line also. So we basically have three approaches. We have learning curves, we have exponential extrapolations, and we have, you know, whatever your macroeconomic model is producing. So here's a range of appliances. Again, we have some historical data, and then we produce the best fit extrapolations for the various historical data. And we've done it for clothes washers and room air conditioners, furnaces, central air conditioners, and refrigerators in our case. So the implications in our national net benefit calculation is that it does, especially, you know, in the refrigerator's case, when we were looking at the different levels to set the mandatory requirement, the levels were coming out at very similar net benefit numbers. And so any change in the price projection, and in this case we're saying, okay, the first cost is going to decline over time, does have a very significant impact on which level winds up being the maximum net benefit in that case. And similarly, when we were looking at the air conditioning case, it has a rather significant impact. And in our regulations go through clearance through the Office of Management and Budget, which looks at the methodologies and the general results of the regulatory analysis. And they want the regulations to have maximum net benefit. So the next research challenge, which has started to be addressed to some extent by the previous speaker, is addressing the rate of change of the cost of efficiency. Because really, it's the incremental cost of efficiency that has the big impact on whether or not there is an incremental benefit for the consumer. What we have done in the methodology that's incorporated to date is we have assumed that the incremental cost of efficiency is declining at the same rate as the overall relative price of the appliance. And that may or may not be true, it'll depend on the case, but in the case where the incremental efficiency is perhaps produced by a new technology, that new technology may be higher up on the learning curve and it may decline at a faster rate. You know, in the case where the incremental technology has some high cost component that doesn't decline over time, that, you know, the incremental efficiency cost may decline slower. So summary, experience curves or price trends are now part of the US analysis. There's an extensive literature supporting its use. Previous analyses with price trends, you know, since price trends are real, may have undervalued the consumer benefits. The analysis changes are data driven, and the price trend estimates are likely to be conservative in many cases and include error bars or sensitivities. And we continue collecting more detailed data when available, and we are doing continuing research on improving the methodologies. So, and that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robert. That was reassuring to hear that you're using experience when you're developing further. Do we have any questions to Robert?
I think because I no longer work at the lab or for the USDOE, I can speak a little more freely. And I just wanted to say that I think Robert has been incredibly modest in what he's been talking about. His research is great, but the political process that he went through to get this through was quite extraordinary in a very conservative DOE, despite the current government and despite Secretary Chu. And I was leading on TVs and co-leading on electronics, and I remember having to present data to DOE to show them that electronics prices declined. And I hardly showed any of my own slides, because it's so difficult to convince them with that kind of material. I showed only industry slides, and what Robert did in getting this to be a mainstream part of the analysis is a huge, huge change. And really, I just wanted to bring that out.
David Baumgart of the chemical company BASF. So thank you for the very, very interesting presentation. And I have one additional question. I didn't see if you had taken into account an assumption on a kind of theoretical limit of the energy efficiency. So it would be assumed that at some point of time there is a certain limit, because to produce a machine or to keep it running, you still need some energy for the law of physics, and there is some limit somewhere. And I don't know if you have a scientific view on how to calculate that, or if it makes sense at all. I do not.
Yeah, so there's two components to the answer. So the particular curves and extrapolations here are extrapolations on the price assuming a constant quality or performance of the product. So that's one piece of the answer. But there's a second piece of your answer, which is if you are looking at an efficiency improvement rate, how might you do an extrapolation that took into consideration the appropriate theoretical limits? And I would argue that in that particular case, the key thing that you would need to do is you would have a physical engineering model, a conceptual theoretical model of how the machine worked. Given the theoretical model of the machine, then you could calculate from the second law of thermodynamics the thermodynamic limit of the machine performance, assuming basically zero increase in entropy. And then that the zero change in entropy limit of the theoretical machine would provide you the physical theoretical maximum efficiency. And then efficiency would be the inverse of the losses relative to that zero entropy change theoretical limit. So that would be my off-the-cuff technique for calculating the limits that you're talking about.
Thank you. Any further questions?
First, let's say we have a TV with OLEDs. At some point, you might start produce energy with it instead. So maybe the theoretical limit would be how much can this TV produce sometime in the future. So it's not necessarily that we can only go to somewhere above zero. We may even go to appliances that start produce energy while they do a job for us. So
in that case, your theoretical picture of the machine changes.
Yeah.
So yes, there's many other changes, and especially when we get to controls, which can potentially produce increased consumer utility and consumer benefit, then again, you get this sort of change in your definition of the machine. Yeah. And when we go to the next generation of efficiency, where we're really trying to break out of the box, then we are going to want to break out of our limited conception of what the machine is to increase more output per unit energy input.
And then I have a question. I'm not sure I understood completely, but is it correctly understood that you use the normal price trends for assuming, so it's not the always the incremental?
So
it might be even better, and that's where you try to refine the models, but today it's simply assuming that prices will go down. And
yeah, it could be better, it could be worse. In some of the products, what happens is the efficiency design option may be something like converting from aluminum to copper, and a limited resource like copper may actually inflate faster than inflation on average. And so in that case, by doing the incremental analysis, you would get a worse, you know, price trend than the average. But yes, you know, the incremental will have likely a different.
I wondered if you're in your research where you're looking at price trends and the value that it brings to companies as they're able to capture more market share and bring the prices down, if you also looked at the competitive benefit to companies of MEPS programs. So for example, if you have an ambitious MEPS level, companies within your jurisdiction have to innovate faster and then have technology that is exportable to other economies that may not have such ambitious requirements. And I wondered if there's been any analysis on sort of in global markets, where we have global markets and we're doing trade between different economies, if innovation, MEPS-driven innovation, and the value that brings in global competitiveness has been assessed. Have you seen that anywhere?
The short answer is no. The longer answer is there's probably two different approaches. So one approach is to try to do some sort of competitive market share modeling, right? There you get in the unenviable position of trying to decide what policy to do depending on which players in the market are going to win. I'm not sure that's a political set of problems that we would want to do. I think a more interesting type of analysis would be given in a more global sense, if the increased efficiency frees up value globally by decreasing expenditures on fuel, then does that savings in the global consumer budget allow an increase in the consumer products budget that allows consumers to have higher quality products over the long term? That type of analysis would be particularly interesting to developing countries, where per capita they may be spending 10% of their household budget on energy expenses. And if they drop that down to 5%, they can be spending that 5% on durables and increasing the fundamental consumer value of their household infrastructure. I think that's perhaps the more interesting version of that analysis.
Thank you very much, Robert. And I think we'll have some more questions later on. And I wish you have had presented all these research results some 5 or 6 years ago when I was working for the Department of Enterprise and Energy and Communications in Sweden with implementation of Energy Service Directive. Because the discussions we had all the time was with the hardcore economists, if there was any empirical evidence for this, and they continuously said, no, you can't prove it, energy efficiency is not cost efficient. So I wish I had had that at that time. Anyhow, we are now continuing, and the next speaker is Mr. Hans Paul Siderius from NL Agency, and we are going to hear about applying learning curves in eco-design measures. Welcome.
Thank you, Agneta, and good afternoon, everybody. Well, I'm sure after Robert's talk, everybody is awake, and I might have some repetition in this presentation on applying learning curves in eco-design measures, but I think that's a good way of getting the message across. So directly jumping into the matter, why applying learning curves, and for you that are fully awake, you directly, of course, spot the first arrow, in this presentation, that is the Ecodesign Directive is not 2010-30EC, but it's 2009-125. So that's for the detail. Yes, I did this by heart and I always mix them up. But why are we doing this? I think as in the US, also in Europe, we want the most out of our regulation, and we want to have the most ambitious standards within the legal framework of the directive. And the legal framework of the directive in the annex says that the standard is to be set at minimum life cycle cost. And so the fundamental or direct question comes up, what is the life cycle costs? What are minimum life cycle costs? What is the assumption between using life cycle costs for setting eco-design, minimum efficiency standards? How can learning curves play a role? And I must say on beforehand that this presentation and these ideas are ideas and not as far developed as in the US, where they are already part of the analysis. Then thirdly, I will give some estimates of extra savings that could have been achieved with the measures that will come into place when we would have applied learning curves. And I also will spend some time on televisions in addressing the question, what if the assumption, and the assumption is that energy efficiency and the price of the product are related, what if does that assumption is not fulfilled? So first, starting with some basic on life cycle costs, it has been shortly touched upon in the foregoing presentations, but I think it cannot be very bad to indicate a bit more in detail. Life cycle costs are, of course, the purchase price of the product, and that's what all the learning curve stuff, experience curve stuff is about. What is called the present worth factor depends on the lifetime, and to discount the future operating expenses to one point in time. The yearly operating expenses, the end-of-life costs, and the repair and maintenance cost. And to keep the whole mathematics and calculations simple, we mostly neglect the end of life and repair and maintenance, or maybe not neglect, but we assume that they are not different for products with different efficiencies, which may not be true, but as a first assumption, it is usable. And also, if you assume that the increase in the electricity or energy price is equal to the discount rate, what you assume that your savings or in general money is worth, then you can simplify the formula even more and make all kind of calculations. Maybe not so much easier, because the calculations are done by Excel, but you get much more insight in looking at the numbers. As I said, the assumption behind using life cycle costs and hitting the minimum life cycle costs is that the purchase price is a relation between purchase price and the total operating expenses through the efficiency of the product. If the efficiency increases, then the purchase price increase, which is not that nice, but luckily also the operating expenses decrease, which is nice. And in the end, you want the sum, so to say, of the arrows going down. And there are, of course, different options for achieving these improvements. Well-known, refrigerator freezers, increase insulation, use vacuum panels, improve compressor efficiency, or use a compressor with variable speed. All options for the product that probably increase the product price, also increase the efficiency and thereby decrease the operating expenses. And the question is, of course, how much can we increase the product price up to the point where it's no the decrease in operating expenses is no longer worth the increase in product price. This, I think, in general explains why this product price and the development of the product price over time is very important. And in Europe, luckily, we have these efficiency improvements classified by energy classes, A++, A++, A++++, and that gives for at least a number of household products, it gives a kind of neutral way to describe a certain efficiency level, because it, take the example of the refrigerator, it can be met with various technology options. And so this in general leads to these kind of curves, and they should be very familiar for you from the preparatory studies from Ecodesign. Mostly in these studies, the horizontal axis on the bottom is design options. I've here labeled it energy label classes because, as I said, this is a more general and neutral way to describe the efficiency improvements. And you see the life cycle costs. This is also taken from refrigerators, which is a very favorable research topic because there is a lot of data available. And you see that the least life cycle cost with a static product price, so a product price that is set at the time of the analysis and then more or less kept constant, is here at the A plus level. If you now would allow a dynamic product price, so a product price that decreases over time, then your life cycle cost curve might change. And in this case, this would lead to the minimum being a double plus. So that's very direct how dynamic product prices influence life cycle cost curves and the setting of standards. And you also see when the curve is fairly flat, then already a small change in price can make a huge difference in terms of energy efficiency classes. That immediately, of course, brings the question, well, shouldn't there be any sensitivity analysis and differentiation in use and so on and so on? Of course, this all can be done in the analysis. Now, how are we going to use learning curves or experience curves? I won't battle about the name, but both capture the effect of that. Once you produce more of a product, you learn, you get more experience, there's economies of scale, and so on and so on. How do you capture this? And this formula was already shown by Robert. It's the cost at a certain cumulative production volume. That's the cost of the first product, which in the rest of the, you could say, well, can you estimate that? It's not relevant in the rest of the story. It's the experience parameter, which is interesting and which we will use. And the learning ratio is derived from the experience parameter, and that's the reduction in costs when the production volume is doubled. So you can imagine that when there is the start of a certain product, a new product, you get these doublings very easily, but once you have produced 100 million, then the doubling will take some time. So that's, if you look at these curves, they're always at a log-log scale, and there's where the linear relation comes from. There are learning ratios from the literature. The sources have already been meant or have already been indicated by the other speakers. The lowest, the LCD television I derived from data I got or I got from the internet on LCD television sales and worldwide street prices. And you see indeed that as an electronics product. As was said before, this learning rate is much higher than the traditional appliances and also the CRT television, but we come to televisions later. Now, there are two ways of integrating learning curves in life cycle costing, and looking at a refrigerator, freezer, I will show you how this could be done in the EU case. If year zero is the year of the analysis and you will set your minimum efficiency target somewhere in the future, year four, year five, then first the assumption is that the base case product has a constant life cycle cost. So for the base case product, a refrigerator, freezer, where already say hundreds of millions are produced over that short time, we assume the price is constant. But this is not true for, you could say, the add-ons that you have for reaching, achieving the A plus or the A plus plus or the A triple plus class. These require, you could say, innovations, and on these innovations, these innovative part of the price, we apply the learning curve, and then you see that not for all, but for the A plus and the A plus plus product, the price comes down, and or the price comes down, and the life cycle costs will at some point be lower than for the base case. And another point is that it's also able, you're also able to assess at the time of the analysis what is the most efficient product on the market. And in this case, this is A double plus. It's a bit masked, but you see that at year zero, there's no point for the A triple plus in the figure. So that product was assumed to come later on the market. Now, there are two, you could say there are two ways to now integrate learning curves into life cycle costing. First is what we do with Ecodesign. We have a fixed time period. We say we want the minimum efficiency standards come into force 4 years, 5 years after the analysis. We can calculate then the new life cycle curve with dynamic pricing. Could also use a top runner approach, and that is saying, okay, at year zero, we know that A++ is the most efficient product. How long does it take before that product has an equal life cycle cost to the base case product? And as you will see for refrigerators, and these curves are all based on average European data, this will deliver different results. Because say we have an eco-design period of 5 years, then after 5 years, you will see that A++ delivers the least life cycle costs of all the products of A. Of course, A+, A++, and A++, and so that would be the eco-design standard. But the top runner product, which was identified in year zero as the A++ product, reaches already parity equivalence on life cycle costs at a bit more than 3 years. So this is also, at least it became clear for me, why with the top runner approach you can set more stringent targets than we normally have with eco-design. What does that bring? I've done some estimates on dryers and refrigerator freezers, non-frost. The current approach, which you can all see in the preparatory studies and now the regulations, is that the condensing dryer will come to a B, the refrigerator, freezer to A plus as minimum requirements. And as you've seen for the refrigerator, freezer, and you can do the same exercise for the condensing dryer, the Ecodesign approach and also the tap runner would bring you to A double plus, and you would save more than the same amount that you're saving now if you would go to that more stringent levels. And there are some assumptions behind it, taking into account that, for instance, also with the current approach, there would be some sales in the more efficient classes, but this is a first rough estimate of the extra savings you would have, which are, I think, not neglectable. Now, I come to TVs. Does this also work for TVs? One answer is no, because the price is not related to energy efficiency, to energy label class in TVs. And here you see some price data per energy label class from, restricted in number, but public sources. There's a nice German magazine, Computer Technik, that every year publishes some data on televisions. There's also consumer tests. And from this graph, there's no, maybe if you really would calculate, you might see that maybe even the most efficient TVs tend to be a little bit cheaper. So in this case, the exercise we've done, we've seen in the foregoing slides, you cannot do, it has no value because there is no life cycle cost curve that is dependent on energy efficiency class. So that is a pity, but as I showed you before, there is a learning curve for television. So the other answer would be yes, it works for TV because the price of TVs does decrease in time, and it decreases very, very nicely in time. It's more, sometimes you think that manufacturers plan upon these curves, but that also might not be completely true. So you can take into account learning curves when planning maps for televisions, but not in a way, I think, that you use lease life cycle costs, but in a way that you use the price decrease of appliances to, you could say, to negotiate the time spent with manufacturers at in what time efficiency improvements should be absorbed in the appliances. And I've not put this on a slide, but if you look at the efficiency improvements in the average of the average TV on the European market, it's also a nice exponential trend. And if you extrapolate that, then it would mean that in 2016, the average energy efficiency index of TVs would be 0.11. So that is also would also be a way to project and to discuss. Concluding, learning curves, in this case learning rates, can be used to set more ambitious eco-design efficiency standards within the current legal framework. I hope I've shown you at least two examples where it was more or less relatively straightforward with the data that comes of the preparatory study and maybe a bit more extra from GfK to show that. Learning rates are available for a large number of products, and I think the nice thing is that for most products you can use universal worldwide learning rates, because certainly for large appliances and ever more for, or even more for, consumer electronics and computers, it's a worldwide market, it's a worldwide production volume. Learning rates can be integrated in life cycle costing when energy efficiency is related to the product price. And for products where this is not the case, and I've shown this for televisions, but I bet the same situation will be occurring with computers, with laptops, with mobile phones. You will certainly see a learning rate, a cost curve that will come down, and you can use the timing of that cost curve to set your timing for the measures. Thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Hans Paul. So do you have any questions? One there from Peter.
Just a small question to both you and Robert. I mean, learning curves, the models you have, they sort of hide the learning. Learning could be how to produce something, but it could also be the social learning, the pressure from the surroundings. You have the early adopters and you have the imitators, as we discussed. If you want to enhance the innovation rate, could we address these two separately somehow? R&D for production technology, and deployment, things like procurement or information campaigns on the consumer side. Could you, because your model doesn't say anything about why
No. The
parameters are like they are. We don't learn anything from your models.
Well, first apply them, that would already be nice because it delivers more energy efficiency. No, there is no model behind it for reasoning why prices drop or why efficiency is related to price, at least not directly, and how this could be improved. Maybe one. This could be could give some more a bit more information on the relation between price and cost and the drivers for price and cost, and there of course your instruments could be applicable. As we've heard, the problem is always you want for nice impact assessments for manufacturers, you want to use cost, but they will never tell you. So instead, prices are used. There's another reason to use prices, because that is what consumers are confronted with in the end. But from this, you see that the price structure and the cost structure are two different things. And I think this model could be used to discuss and see more of the learning you mentioned and your impacts.
So there is also an interaction between adoption, which you might consider consumer learning, and some of the learning rates, because the learning is based on the cumulative production experience for a particular technology. So I think in Shailendra's talk, when he talked about his econometric models, his model has an interaction between adoption and prices. And I think we're just getting the beginning of that interaction described, but as we get better and better at modeling the interaction between adoption, market position, and prices, which are dropping because of experience and learning, we'll get a better understanding of the types of interactions you're talking about.
That's the reason why also we used the both approaches, because as Hans Paul said, that the cost is difficult to get. We can have some ideas on numbers, but if you, on one hand, you use the cost approach and then you use the market approach, they tend to converge and find some kind of truth, even if it's not the absolute truth, but you get a fair idea how much the investment of the manufacturer goes into the overall final cost to the consumer, because that's the main thing. Either people take the assumption that everything goes to consumer, or they say nothing goes to consumer. But what is the right proportion? And I think getting that magic number is, you need to see it from both angles.
Thank you very much, Hans Paul. And thank you for raising the question, Peter, because I've been sitting here wondering Are we going to talk about it from the consumer's perspective as well, the user's perspective, or are we only going to talk about the producer's, the manufacturer's perspective? So that's an important question, and I think we will be coming back to that. So now for the last presentation in this session, and that's a case study, the challenges and implications with a label for boilers. For boilers encompassing cross-cutting technologies. And we will be listening to Martin Forsén from the European Heat Pump Association.
My name is Martin Forsén. I'm a representative of the European Heat Pump Association. My dear colleague Thomas Novak asked me to send his apologies. He couldn't make it to this meeting here today. So he asked me whether if I could make this presentation instead of him, and I will talk about these challenges and implications with one of the lots within the Ecodesign Directive. As you could see here while we were trying to upload the presentation here, there was almost a fight at the stand here between three parties. You should imagine how the fights have been in the discussions during the development of these criteria for this product group. But first of all, I'll just start with some words. We all are aware of this, but just some quick words on why are we all here today and discussing all these. The energy markets are in transformation. It's moving rapidly, and the governing forces behind this transformation are the energy price development, the changes in energy policies, and also technology developments. The challenges that we're standing for, one of the most important ones, is the security of energy supply. We talk about generation of electricity with a low carbon footprint, talk about a lot of wind and hydro, PVs, and there is also a lot of talk about carbon capture and storage for electricity generation. Another very, very big challenge is how to solve the problems within the road transport sector. Plug-in hybrid cars, pure electric cars, and biofuels. That's what we discuss. A couple of years ago, we adopted the energy package and took on the so-called 2020 targets, where we aim at improving energy efficiency, improving the renewable share of our energy supply, and also improve or reduce the emissions, especially the greenhouse gas emissions. Now, taking those ambitious targets here, that's not enough. Clearly, we need some political tools that will help us to fulfill our targets. And there are several of directives and legislations behind this. I just mentioned a few, and then the ones addressing energy efficiency, the major ones, as I see it, and the Energy Performance of Buildings Directive, the ones that we are here to talk about today, the Energy Labeling Directive and the Ecodesign Directive, which are very closely related to each other. We have also, which is also interesting to discuss, the Eco-Labeling Directive. And a couple of years ago, the Commission realized that the political tools available in order to reach the targets for improving energy efficiency would not take us there. So another study was initiated, and a very, very quick new directive was implemented, and that is the Energy Efficiency Directive. It's not on the screen here, but that has already been adopted. Now, if we focus on the Ecodesign Directive, the overall aim, as I see it, is to impose more energy-efficient products, to extend the very successful energy labeling scheme to more product groups, and improve customer information so that the end consumers can make sound choices, leading in the right direction. And in addition to that, of course, the Ecodesign Directive is aimed to ban inefficient products on the market. Now, the heat pump industry that I represent, we are somehow related to four different product groups within the energy labeling scheme. And those are lot one for boilers, lot two for water heaters, lot six and lot 10 for air conditioners. But today I will only talk about one of the most interesting product groups and also the most, one of the most complex and difficult ones to address. That's lot one on boilers. And this product group encompasses, as you see, oil boilers, gas boilers, electric boilers, heat pumps. So there are many, and there are some other products as well. So there are completely different technologies involved in this product group, and that makes it really, really difficult to address. Now we're mixing up combustion technology with heat pumps. And looking at specifically combustion boilers and heat pumps, we express efficiency completely differently. In the heat pump technology, we talk about the coefficient of performance. And when you talk about boilers, you talk about efficiency in percentages. So it's very, very difficult to compare this, as the energy losses in these type, quite different technologies, the energy losses that we have occur at different stages in the energy chain. So what we need to do then, when we have a cross-cutting technology label, what we need to do is that we need to have some kind of systems approach, and we cannot only talk about the appliance efficiency. We need to have some kind of primary energy efficiency in order to take into account that the losses occur at different stages in the energy chain. And we also need to look at an annual performance. So as you can understand, this is quite demanding to develop some kind of evaluation tool that is suitable for all these different technologies. And not only, what we needed to do is to get this into the mind of old industry. It is very, very difficult for them to change their look and their perception on how to express performance. So what do I mean with the primary energy efficiency then? Like I said, we cannot compare the different products as the losses occur at different stages. If you look at an electric boiler at the appliance level inside the house, it is more or less 100% efficiency. But if you compare that to a boiler had most of their losses, in the combustion inside the appliance itself. While for the electric boiler, all of the losses are related to upstream losses outside the house and to the generation of the electricity that is used to operate the electric boiler. And the same goes for the heat pump, that inside the house is more or less can be considered as an energy multiplier. And the same goes then for the heat pump, but all of the losses can be found upstream the house. Now that was quite difficult then to discuss. We need to address the primary energy efficiency, then we needed a primary energy factor. Ideally, you should use a primary energy factor for all the different energy sources, but in the end, in the compromise, it was decided only to use a primary energy factor for electricity. And that should be used as a standard. As a constant of 2.5, reflecting a 40% overall efficiency in the generation of electricity. In another European directive, the Renewable Energy Sources Directive, the primary energy factor or the generation of electricity is not seen as a constant, but a variable that is changing over the years. But not in this one. And as the performance, particularly for heat pumps, is very much dependent on the temperature levels that it is operating in between. It wasn't enough just to use one climate for the energy label. We actually needed three different climate zones. We also needed to take into account performance at various operating conditions. And also, again, to address that the efficiency is highly dependent on the temperature levels a heat pump is operating at. We needed to take into account the efficiency at two different heat distribution systems, addressing two completely different temperature levels in the heat distribution system. However, the calculation methodology and the label does not at all address greenhouse gas emission. This is purely addressing energy efficiency. The three different climate zones that are addressed is a warm climate zone represented by Athens, an average climate zone by Strasbourg, and a cold climate represented by Helsinki. So after a couple of years, several years, I'd say, when we finally came to an agreement on a calculation method on how to evaluate all these different types of technologies, we ended up with finding or trying to find the different levels for efficiency requirements on the label, for the label scale here. It might be a little bit difficult to see from the back here as the sun is coming in, but that's what we came up with, or we, that this is the proposal from the Commission. It was after long discussions. And also, it was discussed how to set the Ecodesign requirements. And these are the Ecodesign requirements for fuel boilers, electric boilers, and heat pumps. And these are for the two tiers that are proposed. One that come into force 2 years after the directive is taken. And that what was a little bit difficult to see was that the scale was looking quite differently. So what we tried to do is to visualize it more graphically. This is actually how the requirements are set to reach the different labels here. So as you see at the bottom, starting with G, in order to encompass the poor performing electric boilers, we needed that. And then we have the E and F, very narrow span, and then a giant span to reach D. And then CBE, where we expect to find CBA, where we expect to find most of the combustion boilers. Some of the combustion boilers might reach A+, but typically what it will, how it will have an impact on the market for boilers is that we will see that quite a few boilers will require to become a hybrid boiler, to use in addition, in connection with the boiler, a solar thermal collector, and sometimes even a heat pump in connection. What is also foreseen that for the time being, heat pumps will reach A plus and A double plus, and hardly any other technologies will reach that level. So that means, all in all, that all the heat pumps will be found only in one or maybe two labels. We cannot really differentiate with these set here. So now we need to be innovative, and going back to the presentation by Rubin here this morning, we need some new thoughts brought into the label already now, actually. And especially since we find that all the heat pumps will be found in A plus or A double plus, we need some way to push the heat pump technology further, to give them some incentives in order to increase their performance. How to differentiate the performance within the heat pump family. And the proposal from the industry, which has been positively received from several directorates, is that we will introduce the efficiency value on the label. And the efficiency value then expressed in a percentage rate will be visualized at the bottom of the label. So making this visual to the end consumer, we can really enforce some drives to the industry to be the top runner in the heat pump family as well. However, we do stand in for several challenges for the future, our technology as well. It is already now foreseen as being the most efficient technology recognized in these two directives. But there's still room for improvement. There were some questions and some talks about the theoretical limit of efficiency for different technologies. What we can see is that for combustion technologies, we are pretty well off. We cannot gain a whole lot more with pure and simple combustion technology. You can maybe gain some percentages still. But for the heat pump technology, we still got quite some room for improvement. And when it comes to the theoretical limit for a heat pump, it is theoretically only set by the two different temperatures it is operating in between. And what we see is that for the future, we expect that we could reach, and it is within also, I'd say, economical reach, to reach 50% of the theoretical limit. What is stopping us to reach 100% of the theoretical limit is that we have some implications that stops us from this. We introduce temperature differences between the heat source and the heat sink with the heat exchangers that we need in the heat pump. It's one heat exchanger on the warm side, and it's one on the cold side. Sometimes it's even more than one heat exchanger. I'd say most of the time it is more than one heat exchanger. So if we look at the heat exchangers, we can make them more compact, but still, already now, they are very efficient, and there is very little temperature difference in between the mediums in the heat exchangers that we are using today. So I'd say that the possible savings that we can do there is less than 5%. If we're only talking about the heat exchangers inside the heat pump unit itself. Now, I'd say that the biggest improvement within the appliance itself is in the field of improving the compressor efficiency. Right now, we are in the best compressors operating, reaching, I'd say, an isentropic efficiency somewhere around 70%. Maybe we can improve that to 80 or even slightly higher. That will, however, take some time, and it brings a lot of cost. At the time being, I hope that we, with the experience from all over, can reduce this cost of those improvements that we can see. We are already now using electronic expansion valves in the most advanced heat pumps. That can improve the efficiency with an additional 2 to 3%, but one should keep in mind that this has already been implemented in the best products on the market already now. Then we have a major challenge, and could be also seen as some in the industry as a threat, and that is related to the use of refrigerants. Today, the refrigerants that we use in most heat pumps are so-called F-gases. And now the F-gases have no effect on the ozone layer, however, they are quite strong greenhouse gases. And that means that there should be a regulation looking into the treatment and handling of these type of chemicals. And right now there is a new revision ongoing on the existing F-gas regulation. If this comes into force and will stop us from using the refrigerants that we are using today, there are alternatives, but there are some drawbacks with the existing alternatives that we have. One is to use CO2, carbon dioxide, as a refrigerant. However, that has some severe drawbacks in most applications in terms of efficiency. The other alternative is to go to hydrocarbons, very efficient and very good refrigerants. However, they are flammable and sometimes even explosive. So there is certain concern about those type of refrigerants for the future as well. And that is the biggest challenge for the heat pump industry today. But we believe and we're quite confident that with this legislation that hopefully will come into force very soon, will help us to provide the end consumers with a transparent comparison between combustion technologies, heat pumps, and other new hybrid combustion boilers together with solar thermal collectors, micro CHP, and other technologies. It is a big step forward, but it also sets some major challenges on the label itself that will allow for a different look on the label. And with that, I stop my presentation. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Martin. Do we have any questions for Martin? And now the sun is really difficult here,
it
so
was.
I have to yes. shade myself.
Peter Nielsen, Danish Energy Agency. Thank you for the presentation. I understand that the Heat Pump Association very much favor that the efficiency value of the product is on the label. So what are your comments that there are strong pressure groups that want to take out the efficiency value from the label?
Well, our comments is, of course, that we want it in. We want it to be visual. We can also understand that other technologies don't want it in because it becomes quite obvious that there is a major change in efficiency in terms of the choice of technology.
It's not directly related to your presentation, but since apparently there are not any other questions, I have heard that heat pumps in Sweden have a much larger market share than elsewhere in Europe, and that even half of the sales in Europe would be in Sweden. I don't know if this is correct, this information. But if so, could you explain why is it so much cheaper in Sweden, or what factors make the difference?
Okay, thank you for raising the question. It's you're quite right. Sweden is the most advanced heat pump market in Europe. And what is the reason behind that? Well, I would like to say, as we have quite a few manufacturers based in Sweden, that the reason was that we've got skilled engineers in Sweden. But that's really not the only case. They are very good. However, the reason why the market has been growing rapidly in a short time is that it has become economically interesting to invest in an energy efficient system. And that is, I can boil it down to that to be the one and only reason. It is of importance for us to reduce the energy bill. And we can thank the politicians in Sweden that they have had fairly high taxes on fossil fuel that makes it economic interest. What we have done in Sweden is that we have phased out almost to 100% the use of heating oil for heating purposes. And this is in the single family house sector, mainly due to the enormous introduction of heat pumps. And in the sector for multifamily homes and other types of buildings, it's due to the fact that the district heating industry have changed from oil to biomass mainly. So you need the economics to be there. And that is really important. And that is also the explanation why we haven't seen a major growth in sales of heat pumps in the UK, for example. In the UK, I'd say that the discussion is completely different. In the UK, there is an enormous pressure on the politicians to avoid fuel poverty. So they do whatever they can to avoid raising the taxes on fossil fuel. And to some extent, my guess is that the same goes for the US. The price of fossil fuel is much too low, and there is too much pressure on the politicians not to touch it with increased taxes.
Another reason for the heat pumps to be so popular in Sweden is, of course, that we had a lot of single family houses which were heated by electricity, and then introducing heat pumps was a very good thing for them to do. So there are several reasons for the Swedish number of heat pumps.
Yep.
I had a question to you, Martin, about the labeling and the eco-design labeling. When we heard earlier on Nils, when he was talking about the case study on circulators, he said that it varies very much from country to country, so there's still a lot to do, and we really need the labeling anyway. I didn't really interpret you when you said that there are so many differences in the countries between how you look upon the heat pumps, that you had the same view on how to use eco-design and the labeling as Neil said. Did I misunderstand you?
Well, I'm not sure I understood you correctly, but what I can say about the importance of the label for the future is different from country to country in Europe for us, for our technology. I'd say in Germany and France, Switzerland, Austria at least, the main importance is that we can, on the one and the same label, compare different technologies so that the end consumer can get an understandable comparison between the heat pump technology, what it can offer in terms of efficiency, and the limitations, to really show the limitations of the old fossil industry with their boilers, the limitations of that industry. In Sweden, there is no market at all for boilers. So in Sweden, I just received the statistics for the sales of boilers in Sweden last year. And the association that is calculating the sales statistics, they didn't report even one single boiler. And I said, that can't be. Well, of course it can't be. There has to be a few boilers sold, but there are less, I'd say that there are less than 100 boilers sold in Sweden, 2012.
And 100,000 heat pumps.
Well, our market is also decreasing due to the recession, so we didn't reach more than around 70,000 to 80,000, that's our guess.
Well, it's a major difference.
Yeah, it's a major difference. So what we need the label for in Sweden is to differentiate in between the different heat pumps. And then it's really the letters are not enough, because we will have find all of the heat pumps within one or two letters. So what we really need is a way to express the calculated efficiency. That is a must for us.
Okay, thank you once again, Martin, and I open up for questions to all of the four presenters for this session. So please, questions.
Hans-Paul, you mentioned something about the curves being very smooth in electronics and whether the manufacturer's designed to the curves. And it made me think of a conversation I heard at the Consumer Electronics Show about Hertz's Law and how Hertz's Law has been in operation for over 40 years and working strong. And a number of manufacturers were discussing whether that was because Hertz's Law is correct or whether it was because everyone designed to Hertz's Laws. So I don't know if you want to say something about that, but that's the only thing I can think about for coffee.
It might be the same as with Moore's Law. Once everybody knows it, then there's also always a possibility that future trends are developed upon that. So that's...
Yes, just a question about heat pumps market and the label. It's interesting that in Sweden, that is a cold country, it's the winning market. And in the southern Europe, that is more efficient, a heat pump. compared to Sweden, could be a really winning technology, and you didn't see any different or differentiation in the label?
Well, I'm not sure how much the label will make it possible for the end consumers and also for policymakers to see the difference in efficiency. However, if you're just looking at market forces, if you are to look at one specific parameter that tells a lot if there is an interest for heat pumps on that market or not, then you need to look at energy price ratios. And with energy price ratios, I mean the end consumer price for 1 kilowatt hour of electricity over the price of 1 kilowatt hour heating with competing technologies, oil and gas. Typically, in Sweden, this energy price ratio has been between 1.2 up to 1.7. This energy price ratio sets the requirement of the seasonal or annual performance factor that you need to come above in order to reduce your heating bill. So in countries like Belgium, for example, where the energy price ratio were between electricity and gas is somewhere in the range of 4. You need to have an extremely efficient heat pump system in order to actually reduce your heating bill. So look at the energy price ratio, and then you can find out where to find the interesting heat pump markets in Europe.
Another dimension of that is that heat pumps is, I have no very good research evidence on this, of course, but to my mind, heat pumps is one of the few products where life cycle costing has really been a positive thing, where it has been used very much to get the consumers to install it. And is that the price ratio you're talking about that really has been big enough here when it comes to heat pumps, or is it something else that really spurred the use of life cycle costing when it comes to selling heat pumps in Sweden, for instance?
Well, of course, that the life cycle cost is dependent purely on the price of heating then, and then if it's an electrical heat pump, it's the price of electricity. And then it's quite easily to calculate the cost savings when you switch to the alternative. And the payback time for an expensive ground source heat pump system in Sweden is typically now down to 6 to 7 years.
But still the difference in investment is so big between a boiler and a heat pump. I mean, it's maybe 3,000 euros for a boiler and 15,000 euros for a heat pump in Sweden. And when it comes to the example of energy efficient tap water heater, tap water mixers, it's a tenth of that, and still you don't get a pickup of the domestic heat water mixers at the same speed as the heat pump. So I think it's interesting if we could study why did the heat pumps manage so well with life cycle calculations?